Thanksgiving service, one of the things that this does is it reminds us not only of the friendships and the fellowships that we have down here, but it reminds us of the fellowship that is to come when we all gather home in the presence of God. This morning, would you stand and join as together we sing, "Some glad morning when this life is o'er, I'll fly away." 1, 2, 3, 4. Just a minute to remember those who we have lost in the past year. The scriptures say to us, blessed is the death of one of his saints in the sight of the Lord. And even though it may hurt us still here, it's a blessing to know that they are experiencing that homecoming in the presence of God today. So join us for this time of remembrance. Thank you.
with eyes on Jesus, I'll slip away to heaven's beauty and perfect day. I'll see my Savior when I am home. My hope is steadfast, my faith is strong. On gates of pearl, on streets of gold, surrounded by the saints of old, I'll see my loved ones at the throne on the day when I go home. When I go home,
no mind can fathom glory there, no separation, no pain to bear, because of Jesus the price was paid. I'll sing forever, amazing grace, on streets of pearl, on streets of gold. Surrounded by the saints of old, I'll join with loved ones at the throne on the day.
Everything is there. I'm moving, wanting. for anything down there. My master has prepared for me a place to call my own. I'm moving to the big house. His house is now my home. Well, now I'm
moving to the big house. I'm ready to go. My master's on the front porch. He's holding the door. I've gone and been adopted as his very own. I'm moving to the big house. His house is now my home.
No, I never will be homesick for that old place of mine. I'm settled in and cozy until the end of time. Don't even try to reach me, I won't come to the phone. I'm moving to the big house, his house is now my home. Well, now I'm
moving to the big house, I'm ready to go. My master's on the front porch, he's holding the door. I've gone and been adopted as his very own. I'm moving to the big house, his house is now my home.
Well, now I'm
moving to the big house, I'm ready to go. My master's on the front porch, he's holding the door. I've gone and been adopted as his very own. I'm moving to the big house,
I'm moving, moving, moving.
Thank you, gentlemen. Now, just so that you know, that last song, Moving to the Big House, was written by Walt. So, thank you, Walt. This is a time when we worship through giving. If our ushers would come forward at this time, and we will celebrate as Brother Jack taught us to do. God loves a cheerful giver. So let's celebrate the chance to give back to the Lord.
Father, we do come to you in celebration of who you are, of what you've done for us, for all that you've provided. I thank you for this Sunday and what it means to us in the history of our church. We're celebrating the things that have gone before us and even the things that are yet to come as we call a new pastor. Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for those that have been faithful before us through the years. Father, help us to do the same, to be the light that we need to be in the world, to stand up, to take a stand for Jesus in everything that we do. Guide us and lead us, and Father, help us to give from the heart and to know that you're in control of all things. We thank you, and I praise you, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you.
You know, from Brother Jerry starting us off this morning until just now, having all of our musicians done such a wonderful job this morning. Let's hear it for them one more time. Thank you.
Glory, glory, I've been seen.
Children, at this point in our service, we invite you to come down and go to Children's Church with us. And if you would just come to this door right here. You know, now normally when we get to this point in our service, it says in our order of worship that the introduction of our special guest. But if you notice today, it says introduction of our special guests. That's because we are thrilled to have both Michael and Sherry with us today. And we're going to get to hear from both of them. Sherry is going to come first and she's going to sing for us, and then Michael's going to come and he is going to preach, and then we'll have scorecards to see which one we like. But no, we're not going to do that. But I just wanted to let you know a little bit about them. There's a biography published in the program of them. But Michael, I guess when I first got to know y'all were still serving in Saskatchewan, Canada. Michael has served churches in Georgia and Canada, and now he is back as the lead pastor of the Sanford Church in Sanford, North Carolina. Michael is a product of our church, and we are glad to have them back with us. They have, let me see if I can find it here, 2 daughters, 2 sons-in-law, and most importantly, they have 6 grandchildren. So a house full, a table full. And welcome to both of you. We are glad to have you with us. Sherry.
Thank you. Thank y'all so much. And let me just say first, it is such a joy and honor to be here. To be invited once is something, but you must love us a little bit, as much as we love you, to invite us again. And cannot express what an honor it is to be with family and our sweet nanny and friends, new friends and old friends, and some friends that are really more like family. And I remember a lot of you growing up, and I don't know if that makes me old or if it makes you old, but time passes quickly, and thank you for having us today so much. And more than anything, I've felt the presence of the Lord in here today. The singing is absolutely beautiful, and what a joy to be able to minister in song to you. So if you know it, feel free to sing with me.
I love you, Lord, for your mercy never fails me. And all my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up till I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful, and all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire and darkest nights. You are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as my friend. And I have lived in the goodness of God. Oh, and all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. every breath that I am able, I will see of the goodness of God. Your goodness is running after us, running after me. Your goodness is running after us, down. I'm surrendered now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after us, running after me. Your goodness is running after us, running after me. Your goodness is running after us, running after me. With my laid down, I'm surrendered now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after us, running after me. All my life, you have been faithful. All my life, you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will see of the goodness of God.
Oh, just think about it.
Oh. So good. Every breath that I am able, I will see of the goodness of God. Oh, I will see of the goodness of God.
Well, I can tell you the first thing that I feel I have to say is from a song we're all familiar with, we sing often, is praise God from whom all blessings flow. I mean, our God, our Savior, Jesus Christ is so good. Amen. His goodness flows, fills our lives every moment of every day. We can look back at our heritage with Him, our history with God in Christ, and just see His goodness filling every step we take, every moment we live. Amen. God is so good. In fact, I want us to do something for a moment together, for a few moments. I want us to think about how good God is, which means how good God has been to you, your family, how good God has been to your church family and ministry, how good God is and how good He's been. What a thought. What a wonderful thing for us to do. Because here's what that does for us, according to Scripture. As we focus on God and His goodness in this way, it just moves us to praise and worship Him. Not our mental ability to focus moves us to do that. As we focus on God and His goodness, the Spirit of God moves us to worship Him, to even celebrate Him and His goodness, especially on such a special day like homecoming. With that, the second thing I want to say is good morning to you all, and thank you so much. As Sherry's already said, I want to say on both of our behalf that thank you for the great honor and blessing and privilege to be here with you, celebrating the goodness and the faithfulness of God here in this homecoming service. It is priceless to us both. And oh, how being here personally carries me back to such a special time growing up with Mom, Dad, and our family as a young boy. And how so many men and women of God sowed so faithfully and wonderfully into me, my life. And I can tell you without question, I have carried it all with me through my life in ministry right up to this moment here in this pulpit, in this great time of blessing and honor. And I will say to you, it is really, words are inadequate to say how great the honor and blessing is for me. So thank you for that, church. And thank you for being the church you are, have been through the years, especially again early in my life, our family together. And praise God for it all. With that, before we go into the time in God's Word together, before I preach, before we receive God's Word, His message, I want you to join me as I lead us in doing the very best and most blessed thing that we can do to prepare ourselves for what God has prepared for us. Amen. And that is, of course, to pray. So join me as I lead us. Heavenly Father, we thank you in the Lord Jesus Christ this morning that we are saved, we are delivered, we are healed by faith in Christ alone on our way to glory with God. And we thank you for such a wonderful, blessed service already today. We thank you in advance for the word alive by the Spirit of God, aflame by the Spirit. And my prayer, as it's already been, for each and every person here, those watching, worshiping online, that as the word comes forth in the liberty, the life, the boldness, the confidence, the multiplied increase of the Spirit, that every person receiving would receive fully, freely by the Spirit of God, be fully touched, blessed, and changed in Jesus' name. And we just praise you in advance for your word and what you have prepared for us all in Jesus' name. And the church said, amen and amen. See, right there, I've already gotten who knows how many amens. So just check the box. All good. But feel free to worship with me as I present the Word of God, because what we're going to do together is celebrate the faithfulness of God. Our text is coming from 1 Corinthians chapter 1. So if you have your Bible, please go ahead and turn with me there. That is the book of 1 Corinthians chapter number 1. While you're finding your place there, again, as we just celebrated the goodness of God together through song with Sherry, and just as I was exhorting coming up here, for the rest of this message, we're going to celebrate the faithfulness of our God in Jesus Christ. How faithful our God has been to us, to our church in Christ. What a thought, what a truth. And oh, how that moves us to worship Him as well. Of course, this involves us turning around and looking back at our heritage and our history with God, individually and as a church. A heritage, by the way, we would not have except God of His love, by His grace, give us the heritage and history we have in Jesus Christ. And so, when we look at it and think about it this way, His faithfulness is all about this. All that our God has done for us to save us. All that our God has provided for us in Christ to save us. To have us here celebrating the goodness and the faithfulness of God in Jesus Christ. How He has protected us. How our God has fought our every battle and won them all. And on the examples go of how faithful God has been in our lives and in our church up to right now in this moment. Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, and forever. Jesus Christ, the same good and faithful God and Savior, today as He was yesterday and as He will forever be. Amen. But question, how faithful has God been in my life, in all of our lives. I mean, really carefully, prayerfully think about this with me, because it's so important to really see this in truth. How faithful, when we say God is faithful, and we're celebrating the faithfulness of God in Jesus Christ, how faithful is that really in truth? Well, in truth, here's where this starts for us. Our God is faithful means when we were faithless, God was faithful. When we are faithless, God is faithful. Where does that begin for us? When we were lost in our sins, separated from God in our unbelief, which means when I could not get to where my Jesus was, he came to me. When you could not get to where Jesus was, he came to you. When we were in our sins against God and the faithlessness of our lostness, say it that way. Ephesians 2 verse 4 says it this way. But God, not but us or anything else, but God, who is rich in mercy because of his great love with which he has loved us. And then it tacks on, by grace we are saved. Now, I don't know about you, but that's something to celebrate. That faithfulness we see in the two words, but God alone, is something to celebrate in the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen? In his church. And to add even more celebration to God's faithfulness, even after we gave our hearts, our lives, our sins to Christ by faith and trust in him alone, and we were saved, there were times in our lives when we were not sure about the faithfulness of God. I would say, can't be just me. I know it's not just me. There were even times we could not even be convinced in and through things we were going through that God was faithful. Yet God, in spite of our faithlessness, proved his faithfulness again and again. In spite of our faithlessness, God will always prove his faithfulness again and again in and of himself. It's who he is. Our God is faithful. Amen. And with that, let's go ahead and turn to our text in 1 Corinthians chapter 1. And really important that I get my glasses, so thank you for that. I hope I don't rip the tape off that we've got holding the mic on, but we'll get by, however. Verse 1 through verse 9. Paul, called to be an apostle of Jesus Christ through the will of God. And look at the verse there, number 2. To the church of God, to the church of Jesus Christ, which is at Corinth. To those who are sanctified in Christ Jesus, called to be saints, with all who in every place call on the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, both theirs and ours. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I thank my God always concerning you for the grace of God which was given you to you by Jesus Christ, by Christ Jesus, that you were enriched in everything by him in all utterance, in all knowledge, even as the testimony of Christ was confirmed in you, so that you come short in no gift, eagerly waiting for the revelation of our Lord Jesus Christ, who will also confirm you to the end, that you may be blameless in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. Look at this. God is faithful, by whom you were called into the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. While Paul clearly says our standing blameless before God is based exclusively upon God's faithfulness, by whom you were called into the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ. And please understand this in truth, church. We are called into the fellowship exclusively because of what Christ Jesus has done for us when we were faithless. How faithful is our God? Amen. Look at this with me. Hebrews 6, verse 9, 19 and 20, the first part of 20. This hope we have as an anchor of the soul, both sure and steadfast, and which enters the presence behind the veil, where the forerunner has entered for us, even Jesus, having become high priest forever. This reveals the greatest thing that Christ has ever done for us all, and the greatest experience we can ever have this side of heaven in our salvation. He has removed every obstacle that formerly blocked us from God's presence, and literally Christ has carried us all into the holiest of the holies, the heart of God, the heart of His presence, for communion and fellowship with God. Best seen and said this way on our screen, Christ has taken us from zero access to full access into the presence of God. Wow. When I was faithless, He did this for me and you and us all. From zero access to full access into intimate communion and fellowship with Almighty God in Christ. When we were faithless. Why? Because of His unconditional love for us that has now formed His unbreakable covenant with us in Jesus Christ. Unbreakable because it's based exclusively upon the faithfulness of His unconditional love for us, and it is filled with His unending promises to us. As Paul says, full access into the grace upon which we stand. Therefore, as the Bible says here in Hebrews 6, God, His faithfulness, His love and His love for us, God's faithfulness in His unconditional love for us in Christ is truly an anchor of hope for our soul. An anchor of hope that holds in and through all things at all times, guaranteed by God Himself, guaranteed by His unending promises in Jesus Christ. Amen. There's another good opportunity to say yes and amen. The word of God is true. The testimony of God in truth is true in Christ of His faithfulness even when we were faithless. And so for the rest of this message on this sure foundation, I want us to celebrate together as we focus on three very important attributes of God that guarantees the faithfulness of His love in and through all things at all times. And please don't miss this. Each one of these attributes cannot be separated from God's love. God is love. God is faithful. It's who He is. First thing in our next caption on the screen, which is a point of truth, really, God's perfect knowledge guarantees His faithfulness. Think about this mind-blowing truth with me for a moment. God is perfect. God is perfect. He has perfect knowledge. He has perfect vision. He's the one and only, all-knowing, all-seeing God in perfection who sits upon His one and only throne, and that is the truth forever. And so God's perfect knowledge alone of all things at all times for all eternity assures us of some very important truths. First of all, nothing can catch God by surprise. You really embrace that with me. Nothing can catch our awesome mighty God by surprise. Nothing can get past His attention. Nothing can slip through the fingers of His mighty hand. It also means the enemy himself, Satan, is not any kind of loose cannon at all, like some people make him out to be. Is he not the murderer of all murderers? Is Satan not the one who came to seek, whom he may destroy and devour. I ask you, does he want to do that partially or completely? Completely. Why has he not done it by now? Why am I still here? Why am I preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ? Why are we celebrating the faithfulness of God? Because Satan's not in control. He doesn't share in any manner of throne. God Almighty sits upon his throne. God who is faithful. God who is perfect in his knowledge and in every way. That also knows, he knows everything about us at every moment. All the time, always. But again, let's truly celebrate now right here, realizing how God knew everything about us when we were lost and separated from him in our sins. Look at these verses from our scripture listed here, 2 Timothy 2. If we are faithless, he remains faithful. For he cannot deny himself. Wow, there it is. If we are faithless, he remains faithful. If our faith is weak or even fails, our God remains faithful in Jesus Christ. And in remaining faithful, God stays true to himself. Then next, look with me in 2 Peter 3. According to his promise, look for new heavens and a new earth in which righteousness dwells. The sum total of our Christianity is this, brothers and sisters, in truth. Loving Jesus Christ, living for Jesus Christ, and looking for his blessed return. That is our Christian life. That's the summation of it. That's the sum total. Loving the Lord Jesus Christ, living for him, and looking for his blessed return. Based exclusively on God and the faithfulness of his unconditional love for us. Then let's look further in this same chapter at two verses. You therefore, beloved, since you know this beforehand, beware lest you also fall from your own steadfastness, being led away with the error of the wicked, but grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. To him be glory both now and forever. Amen. God says here that we are to, by faith, set our sights on this truth every day. Grow in the knowledge of Jesus Christ, and we will grow in the one whose knowledge is perfect. In his love for us, guarantees his faithfulness every moment of every day, all the way to glory one glad day. Next, mighty attribute of God that guarantees his faithfulness in our lives in Jesus Christ is God's infinite power guarantees his faithfulness. So we have God's perfect knowledge, inseparably God's infinite power. Just as our great God and Savior is all-knowing in his love, he is all-powerful in his love. Psalm 62 sets the table for this. All power belongs to God. The Word of God in Psalms also says, the great word chapter, the Word of the Lord has been established, settled in heaven forever. Amen. The Word of the Lord that's been settled in heaven forever says all power belongs to God. Psalm 68 says he gives strength and power to his people. Don't you want to just celebrate that in his faithfulness, the faithfulness of his love? God gives his strength, his power in his love for me, for you, for us all. Then Paul reveals the working of God's power in Ephesians 3. Now to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us, to him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus to all generations forever and ever. Then next Paul says, as a result of God's perfect knowledge and infinite power working together, now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit, soul, and body be preserved blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. He who calls you is faithful. He who calls you is faithful who also will do it. Now let me apply all that we've been focused on in this truth of God's faithfulness in my own way, in completely a pastoral way. Sherry and I have been blessed, honored, privileged in the call of God on our lives as a lead pastor to serve in for 27 years now in three states, two countries, five great churches total. In all of those transitions and those moves and those awesome opportunities to serve Christ, his people in those communities, in advance, Sherry and I did not have a clue about any of those churches or those people, and nor did they have a clue about who we were. Let me tell you who did, in perfect knowledge, know God. And we're so grateful to say that he brought us all together at each of those appointments. And the same thing is true for us all in our life. He is the God who directs traffic in his kingdom in our lives. He is the God who directs traffic in his kingdom concerning his churches. And I'm excited, Sherry's excited to know that you have a pastor and his family coming this coming Sunday, I think it is. And we're excited praying for you all. But God, in perfect knowledge, his unconditional love, his infinite power has brought you together. It's a kingdom ordained appointment orchestrated by your God who's faithful. Embrace him, embrace it, your family, the new family, and go with God together in all the great purpose and future and blessing he has for you all. Amen. And so with that, this brings us to the next attribute of God that guarantees his faithfulness in his love for us. God's constant presence guarantees his faithfulness. The Bible says God's presence is everywhere and that all of his faithfulness is there in all of those places all at the same time. Wherever God is, his love is, his faithfulness is, because it's who he is. And so God says his presence is everywhere. He's omnipresent. He's in every place, everywhere, all at the same time, and there his faithfulness is with him. It's who he is. Look at Psalm chapter 36 with me here. The mercy of God is in the heavens. His faithfulness reaches through the clouds. Now, what does this mean for us today in Jesus Christ, in the steps we take, the lives we live, the ministry we do? Here it is. There's no place under the earth, on the earth, above the earth, that we can go or be carried that is beyond the eyes and total care of our great and awesome loving God who is faithful. No place beyond the guaranteed faithfulness of God in Jesus Christ because of his constant presence. Where he is, his love is because he is love. Where he is, his faithfulness is because he is faithful. And we are his beloved children in Christ. No matter where, no matter what, he will not leave nor forsake us, and his presence is everywhere at the same time. Therefore, we can now, as we're doing today, and we should really every day as believers in Jesus Christ, on our way to glory with God one glad day because of his faithfulness, his love for us, celebrate it. Absolutely celebrate it. We can and we should sing of God's faithfulness like we've done today together. Because he has proven his faithfulness over and over and over again. And he will again and again and again in your life and in this great church family and ministry. Look with me now at some verses from Psalm 59. But I will sing of your power. Yes, I will sing aloud of your mercy in the morning, for you have been my defense and refuge in the day of my trouble. To you, O my strength, I will sing praises, for God is my defense, my God of mercy. Think about this with me in the context of which God gives us these verses. It was a time when David's enemies were circling him to destroy him. Yet David joyfully proclaims God's faithful love for him and that his faithful God was his strength in that time of trouble. And we say yes and amen with David here, right? Amen. To conclude our time in God's Word, and as the musicians come and get prepared to do what you do, as we get ready to respond to God and His Word, look with me at two more verses from Lamentations 3. Through the Lord's mercies, we are not consumed, because His compassions fail not. They are new every morning. You ever had a sleepless night? You've been just watching that clock, just wishing you could go to sleep. You want to make it something good instantly? When it hits 12:00 and you really wish you were asleep, but you're not, you say, well, at least His mercy is brand new today, and it's going to fill my day. Amen. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness, even when we're faithless. Great, God, is your faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore, I hope in Him. The context here in these verses is this, church. Just before these verses, in verse 18, Jeremiah was saying, hope is lost. There's no hope. But yet we see the verses we just read right after. What could have brought the change to Jeremiah so quickly, who previously, just before, said there is no hope? Then he's saying, great is God's faithfulness, because Jeremiah, something focused him, the prophet, on God and His faithfulness and His love for him. Suddenly hope restored for the glory of God. Amen. How many has been there in your life? You were saved already, but you just weren't sure of God's faithfulness. And there was no hope to be seen or felt or experienced because of the circumstances and situation. Even the world we're living in today, how insane it has become. God is faithful. God loves you with an everlasting love. God has His hand on your life as a believer. God has His hand on your church because of His love for you and His church. And God is going to take you all the way to glory one glad day. I tell you, how faithful is our God, how much hope we have in Jesus Christ. Amen. Stand with me, please. Thank you. As I prepare to lead us in prayer before we welcome you to respond, I want to just say that it's always possible, whether it be a homecoming service or any service where we're gathered as the body of Christ, and we've worshiped and the Word of God's been preached, and now is the response, that someone could be here, maybe more than one, and you know that you've never given your heart, your life, your sins to Jesus Christ and been saved. I want you to know that there's no shame in doing that if that's the case. Even someone watching worship online. There's only love and grace. Amen. Love that gives grace to be saved. And it is the delight of God for all to put their faith, their trust in Jesus Christ as their one and only Lord, Savior, Deliverer, Healer, and eternity. Receive Him and see His faithfulness begin to fill your life and lead you, guide you in every way. The only shame would be to not do that when we really think about it. Amen? The only disgrace would be that they would not accept, respond to the message, the truth of grace. For all others, however God has spoken in and through His Word this morning, live by the Spirit of God, as I've shared with you what God has shared with me to give to you through the Word this morning, however, whatever is needed, steps of faith and liberty, you come. And others will meet you here. Most importantly, our faithful God is here with us and will meet us here. Amen. In the altar, in a time of worship, of dedication, even salvation, to meet with God. Amen? And let me pray for that. Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank You for the great honor, the great privilege to minister to these wonderful people, to this wonderful church family and ministry. We love them all dearly. We appreciate them all dearly. And now, as we open the altar, so to speak, the time of response when we respond to you and your word, again, my prayer is if there is anyone here not saved, they would absolutely take those steps of faith, come to Jesus Christ, lay themselves, their sins, and it all down before him as Lord of all, Savior of all, and receive him and be saved. And all of us who are here as well, having received the word of God, the message you've prepared for us, in every way, whatever is needed, that we would, with confident steps of faith, if we need prayer, others will pray with them as they come. Or if they want to just come and in the liberty they have in the Lord and pray for whatever need they're praying about, whatever reason they're being moved to come and pray, may there be liberty and confidence in God's house, in God's people, as we respond to you and your word. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.